So let's talk about one of the most iconic devices from the classic muscle car era, the Hurst pistol grip shifter, a Chrysler exclusive introduced in 1970. So 1970 was the high water mark of the original muscle car era, the first muscle car era. And 1970 was the year that Chrysler went all out as far as the image stuff goes. That was the year of the introduction of the e-body. All of the colors, the wings, the shaker scoops, the trapdoor air grabbers, the hood pins, and the pistol grip shifter. So to tell the story of the pistol grip, you really kind of got to go back to the beginning of the shifter, the Chrysler 4-speed era, 1964, to see how it all evolved. And answer the question, why was there never an A-body pistol grip shifter? Or was there? Okay, so 1964, Chrysler introduces the A33 4-speed. Previous to that, everything was 3-speeds. It was also the first time there was a floor shifter involved in it. Well, okay, wrong about that. It was the first time a Chrysler transmission was equipped for a floor shifter. 1960 to 62, the original Valiants and Dodge Lancers had a floor shifter, but the floor shifter was actually mounted to the floor with the linkage rods running to the transmission. The A903 and A745, which were the 3-speeds in use at the time, didn't have any provision for a shifter mount. So to that point, everything was done on the column. An exception to that would be the 3-speeds that they used in the 1963, 62, and 63 Max Wedge cars. But we're getting away from the point. 64, they introduced the A833 4-speed. And in 64, it's available behind every engine in the lineup with the exception of the 170 slant 6 and the 318 polyhead for whatever reason. But it was available in the A, B, and C body lines. And I'm going to do a whole video on C-body 4-speeds. So for the time being, we're just going to leave them out of the equation here and only talk about the A and the B-bodies. So 64, in the A and the B-bodies, the shifter that Chrysler used on the 833 4-speed was a nice state-of-the-art Hurst. Good quality shifter. They used a very conventional-looking one in the A-body cars, very similar to the one they used in 1969 and later. And the B-bodies used a gooseneck sort of Hurst thing that came up out of the floor like this and it came over a little bit to the driver and just stood up. Nice looking shifter, but they were expensive. So Chrysler, looking to save a few dollars, in 1966 switched all of the 4-speeds over to the inland shifter. The inland was not a good move. The inland shifter had a reputation, it's had a lot of nicknames over the years, the guess a gear, the wet noodle shifter. Anybody who's ever had a car, a performance car, or tried to put an inland shifter, you know, through the paces, knows how bad they were. They're fine for just driving around, you know, good cruiser, no problem, but you take this thing to the drag strip where you try to bang some gears with it and they just don't want to go. Third gear, getting third gear successfully with one of these shifters is just an act of luck, regardless of how skillful you are. So 1968, they used the inland shifter in 66 and 67 across the board and the early part of 1968. But now they introduced the Roadrunner and the Super B. Initially, those cars had the inland shifter, but now you've got a whole new group of people coming over to the Mopar camp buying these muscle cars and these shifters, they're just junk. So Chrysler, midway through 1968, switched back to the Hurst unit. And it was a conventional Hurst, looking a round stick, looking very much like the 64 or so A-body shifter. The difference, the cost difference between the inland shifter and the Hurst at the time was $40 a unit. So you could, you know, you think about it, that adds up. That was a nice chunk of change in 1968. So mid-1968, 1969, they go to a conventional Hurst shifter. But it was, you know, normal. It was like mundane. It's like, you know, we need something extra here. Well, one of the engineers over at Chrysler, for his own car, carved a pistol grip handle out of walnut, put it on the car, and showed it to his friends. And they were like, this is it. We need this in production. Remember, this is all amping up. This is all leading up to 1970, where they go crazy with the image and the things. So they take this handle that was hand-carved out of walnut, hand it to Hurst, and Hurst gives them back the pistol grip that we know today. And from what I understand, it's pretty true to the original carving of the handle. Couldn't use a round stick with it. That didn't work, so it went with a rectangular stick. In total, there were four versions of the pistol grip shifter. Three of them were available in 1970, and two of them never made it past 1970. So the original or most organic incarnation of the pistol grip was the one found in the E-body. So now here's an interesting thing. Up until 1969, the tail shafts used on the four-speed transmissions only had one mounting pad. So you see on the top is the A-body one, and that's going to be important in a couple of minutes. The bottom is the B-body one. So beginning in 1970, they added a second shifter mounting pad to the back of the tail shaft, and it moved the mounting pad a little bit closer to the center of the car. And the E-body console, which later became the B-body console, the E-body console had the hole for the shifter a little bit further back and a little closer to the driver than the B-body consoles at the time. So it's really the most organic or naturally fitting of all of the pistol grip setups. It puts the shifter right, pretty much right at the driver's knee, more or less, a little bit behind the knee. It's right there at your hand. It's not the best position if, let's say, you're under 6 foot and you can't put the seat all the way back because your second and fourth gears are a bit back, and so you got to move your arm a little bit further back than you want to. But if you're a 6 footer, it's just exactly perfect. So here's the setup as it would appear on a 1970 E-body. So here's the shifter mounted at the back of the tail shaft, and here's the unused part, or I should say the B-body location for the shifter. So that incarnation of the pistol grip with the shifter mounted all the way at the back of the tail shaft and the short shifter was the one used from 1970 through 1974 on all of the E-bodies, and then from 71 to 74 on B-bodies with bucket seats. It's the most common of all of the pistol grip configurations. Now, as I said, there were four versions of the pistol grip. Three of them were available in 1970. Two of them never made it past. So the basic four-speed pistol grip is found on a bench seat car. And the Roadrunners, the Super Bs, they were all stock with bench seats. You could order buckets. But they were bench seat, no console cars. And the standard shifter for that was this one here. Now remember, the basic console was used for both the automatic and the manual transmission cars. And the opening that the shifter would come through was far forward and in the center, unlike the E-body and later B-body console, which had the shifter opening back into the driver's side so that the shifter comes through in a natural position. So for the 1970 and only 1970 B-body console cars, they came up with this thing. So what this shifter does, it's crazy. It comes up out of the floor of the car and then makes a hard right, comes up through the console, and then angles back over to the driver. So you've got this basically an S-shaped shifter, extremely long. But more important than extremely long, it had leverage that worked against you. So in other words, your first to second gear pull is straight back. It'll do that, no problem. But when you go to power shift this thing from second to third, the S shape on the shifter is trying to force the linkage. And remember, you've got the leverage of this really long stick. It's trying to force the shifter to go back into first. And what it'll do is it'll hit the neutral section of the linkage and stop it there. To successfully power shift the 1970 console pistol grip, second to third, was really luck. There was no skill involved in it. It was luck. If you wanted to try to make that shift, in addition to pushing forward on the shifter, you know, preloading the shifter ready for the power shift, you also had to twist it against that rotation that the S is trying to make it go into. Terrible shifter. There was a second problem with this also. Because the shifter was so long, it gave the driver too much leverage over the shift forks inside the transmission. So remember now, if you're going to power shift the transmission, you're going to start pulling the shifter back or pushing it forward against the gear before you hit the clutch. Well, with the console pistol grip, the thing was so long that that same pull, that same amount of effort that you would put into a standard, you know, regular four-speed shifter, well, it amplified it so much that those cars ended up with more from the not when you got into a four-speed console pistol grip 1970 car. The transmission was sloppy. They'd make noise because what would happen was as you're trying to put it through its paces, you're twisting and pushing against the shifter forks with much more effort or much more leverage than they're intended to. So you really don't know your own strength when you're driving one of these things. And because of the way that it's situated, it kind of forces you to drive aggressively. That's the whole thing with the pistol grip is, right, go. So that configuration only lasted the 1 year, 1970. Now in 1971, they redesigned the B bodies. And in that case, when you've got a bucket seat car, you've got the console, and it has the E-body shifter position, which again is really the most organic situation for the pistol grip shifter. But for the bench seat cars, they did something interesting. And then here's where the unborn A-body pistol grip comes from. It appears to me that Chrysler had intended at the same time that they put the pistol grip in the B-bodies, that they were going to also do an A-body version, but they never did it for whatever reason. Sometimes they'll hold things back just to push the buyer, the potential buyer, into a higher priced item. So if the pistol grip shifter is the attraction, well, only make that in the more expensive cars and don't put it in the cheaper cars. I'm only speculating that that's why they did it. But 1971, the shifter they used in the B-body bench seat cars would have actually been a perfect fit for the A-body cars. So here's the car, the 1971 through 1974 bench seat B-body shifter. And here it is a kit supplied by Hurst. So if you want to buy one of these things brand new, this is what you're going to get. So if you notice, it has this dog bone shaped bracket. So that dog bone shaped bracket takes the shifter body itself and moves it back and up when it's bolted in the car. So if you took this shifter and mounted it right to the B-body pad on the 833 tail shaft, it wouldn't fit the car at all. In order for it to actually fit and come through the hole, it has to be moved up and back. Well, this dog bone bracket right here puts it, so here's the B-body position. That dog bone bracket moves the shifter back and up to where it would be on an A-body. So the 1971 through 74 B-body bench seat pistol grip is actually an A-body shifter that they adapted for the later B-body. So it never saw production in an A-body, but it's an exact fit. You do need the right plate to orient it. You need the right shifter bracket to orient it correctly on an A-body. Some people have used I've seen so many times, people use a console, an E-body, or a B-body console pistol grip, the short handle in an A-body. But the problem with that now is that first and third, well, first the shifter is oriented, like, so you're almost pushing it down to shift forward. But first and third are in reverse, or even are so far forward, you almost have to hit your passenger's foot to get it into third gear. But if you do want to put a pistol grip in an A-body, the one to use is the 1971 through 1974 B-body bench seat shifter. And there it is in its natural habitat. It's the best looking of them. And having lived with all of these shifters in so many different configurations over the years, I will tell you point blank, the 71 through 74 B-body gives you the best feel overall. The E-body location, the short handle, it's very tight. It's like, it actually doesn't even really, it doesn't even feel like a Mopar shifter, because Mopar shifters are known to be a little on the sloppy side, a little long throw. So it almost has like a General Motors kind of feel to it. But it doesn't have the right position, the most comfortable position. It doesn't give you the right amount of leverage to work an 833, which is a bulky kind of transmission. But that 71 through 74 B-body bench has just the right length and it's in just the right position that, in my opinion, it's the perfect pistol grip shifter. The downside to these things, there's very little downside to them. They're beautiful shifters. Nothing screams muscle car more than a pistol grip shifter. If there's any downside to them, is that they do feel cheap. You know, it's funny, it's one of those things where it plays with your mind a little bit. When you look at a pistol grip shifter, and you can almost feel the wood. You know, they're sculpted in such a beautiful way. And especially the way your thumb lays over, you know, because you've got the grips that your fingers are going to go over, but there's this whole section in the shifter that your thumb and the inside of your thumb lays against that just feels so natural and tight. And you look at it and you say, well, that's going to feel like wood, right? But it doesn't. It just has a cold plastic cheap feel to it. And as these things age, as they go through, you know, just regular normal heating and cooling cycles, summers and winters, you know, the plastic will kind of like distort a little bit and it'll start to vibrate. If you go back to the day when these things were all around as used cars, like they were all like 6, 7, 8, 10 years old, there was always matchbooks and stuff like that stuffed up between the chrome and the plastic to keep the things from vibrating. It was just the normal thing you did with those. But if there's any downside at all to the pistol grip, that's it. It's a fantastic shifter. So, and then that was the end of it. 1974, E-body was gone, the pistol grip was gone, the B-bodies, we knew it was gone. And when the pistol grip shifter went, so did the last of the real spirit of the Mopar muscle car era, in my opinion. All right, that's it. This went on all different twists and turns, right? I hope you got something out of that. I'll see you tomorrow.